So we will first assume that we have a positive function so that we can draw pictures, but once we translate it to algebra, you will see that the positivity is not used in the expression. So let us start with let us start with f of x, y, a positive function on a rectangle R in xy plane. Okay, so we need this, we need greater than or equal to zero to draw nice pictures. Okay, so that's not obviously required in theory of integration. So we want to understand in this interpretation the volume above the rectangle and under the graph of z equals f of x. Okay, so our first interpretation the volume above the rectangle R and below the graph z equals f of x, y. Okay? So just to say the volume, we need this positivity. Otherwise, if the graph dives below x, y plane, our experience from one-dimensional case tells us that there is also another volume there, if f is nice, but integration will count it as negative volume. Okay, so the picture for this will be the following. Okay, so let me draw this picture. Okay, so as in one-dimensional case, we approximate this volume. How did we approximate it? We use Riemann sum by Riemann sums. Okay. And if this approximation turns out to be precise after we take suitable limits, we will call it the integral. Okay, so idea is the same. So let us draw pictures. So our picture will be something like this. So we are in the xy plane. We suppose that this is our rectangle. Okay, so we assume our rectangle has sides parallel to x and y axis. Okay, so that will be enough. So our rectangle has sides parallel to x and y axis. So, and there is above this, so let us try to see this, above this there is a volume, okay, so this is z equals f of x, y, okay, so underneath this there is a volume, okay, and then we have this, this is, say, z axis, okay, so we want to find this volume. Okay, so we want to find this volume. So last semester we had different ways of finding such volumes using single integrals. You first cut this by a plane perpendicular to the xy plane and say parallel to x axis. Okay, so that gives an area here, and the area depends on where you are cutting this solid, so area is a function of y. You write that, you calculate that function of y, and then you integrate it with respect to y from this point. Okay, so this point goes to here, and this point goes to here. So you integrate that function from here to here. And we also know that we can do it back the other way. We can cut this by a plane perpendicular to xy axis. So it will give you an area here. That area depends on where you are cutting this. It's going to be a function of x. You calculate that function of x. And then you integrate it with respect to x, again, from this point. From this point, okay, let's extend this a little bit to this point. Okay, so now we want to do this in one step. We want to say that the function is given like this. So I want to integrate this. I want to say that the volume of this is double integral of this over this region. Okay, so we want to make this something formal, and then we'll check that it agrees with the previous definition. So it will give us a new horizon to do calculations. Okay, so for this thing we start with the usual Riemann summation formalism. Start with partitioning R. Okay, so let's now consider R here. Okay, so suppose that the picture is such that here this is x, this is y. So this part here is A. As usual, we'll put this A, and then this is C, this is D. Okay, so we'll follow the usual recipe. partition AB into n equal subintervals. Okay, so partition AB into n equal subintervals. So let's just write one of them here. xi, and this is, okay, maybe xi minus 1, xi. Maybe sometimes this is better. This is now, according to this notation, I'll have this as x0. This is xn. Okay. Okay, so in this case, the length of xi minus 1 is b minus a over n. So let us call this delta x. Okay. So what's happening here? Let me do it with a different color. So we have this. And we'll do the same for for CD. Okay. Partition CD into, okay, I can still take it n equal intervals, but let's then it won't help me because CD may not be equal to AB. Then I don't get a square here. In general, I'll get a rectangle. So why not admit it here? Partition CD into m equal subintervals. So again, let's say I minus 1 is equal to C minus D minus C, D minus C over M. Okay, so this is D minus C over M. Let us call this delta Y. So what happened is I did this one here. Okay, so this one is yi minus 1, yi. Okay, so we have a rectangle here. Okay, so we have many such rectangles. And you see the idea is to make m and n larger and larger for a nice partition. Let us call this rectangle rij. Okay, so this rectangle rij. Okay, so maybe I pass here. Okay. Okay, so call this rectangle. Okay, so let me do it over here. Call this rectangle Rij. So Rij, if you want to write it algebraically, this is the set of all xy in the plane, such that x is between these, xi minus 1, xi, and y is between y. So let's make this j, yj minus 1. Okay, so they are all of the same length, so I'll have delta y here. Okay, and choose an arbitrary point. Choose an arbitrary point. Generally, we denote it xi, but the book denotes this with an asterisk, so I'll put an asterisk here. Okay, so somehow this makes it arbitrary. Okay, so this is in Rij. So in each of them, you choose a point, x, I, j, asterisk. Okay, so this is what we want from the partition. We have all these rectangles of area delta x, delta y. And in each of them, we have a point. Okay, so this is what the rectangle serves us. Now, next comes in the function. The function will be evaluated at this point, multiplied by the area of this rectangle. So that will give us a box here. So it will be something like this. There is going to be this box here. And then, okay, so let me draw it like this. So there is going to be this box. Okay, so the point is here. And the point here, this point is now on the surface. Okay, so this is, say, this is xij star. Now this point is xij. So xij has x and y coordinates. So I'll just write then fxij star is on the graph. So you see, this point has, maybe you call it, I don't know, let's call it xi star. So I choose a point xi star here. I choose a point yj star here. So I call that point just one name. Okay. Okay, our hope is that if this rectangle is very, very small, then the volume of this box is almost the volume under the graph here. Okay, so obviously the graph cuts this top part of this box, and it's the two volumes are not exactly the same. Okay, so but we are hoping that in the limit something nice will happen. Okay, so next we form the Riemann sum. Okay, so let's call it S of F on R. And of course, this depends on the partition. So we generally write partition here. But since we use a very special partition, and this partition depends on the integers n and m, so let me write, instead of the partition, just write n, m. To indicate that this sum depends on n and m. Okay, so n and m. So this is summation on I equals, so let's write it like this. I is between this and, so this is the partition. I consider all of these points, ij star. I evaluate the function there. And all of these rectangles have the same area, this side times this side. So delta x, delta y. Okay. So this sum approximates the volume under the graph, z equals f of x y over r when f is positive on r. Okay, this is it, this is our interpretation, so that we are convinced with what we are doing. But forget about this. You see that this sum makes sense whether this thing is positive or negative. Okay, now next we want to take the limit as n and m go to infinity. Okay, when you take a limit, the limit sometimes exists, sometimes doesn't. So we have two cases. F is a nice function if this limit exists on this rectangle. Okay. Now take limit as n and m go to infinity. Okay. So if the limit exists, we denote the limit by double integral of r f f dA. Okay, so at this point I'm not writing x and y dA. Okay. Or sometimes we write this as, these are just notation, over r f of x y dx dy. Okay, so dx dy, you see, is what we expect to write instead of delta x delta y in the limit. Okay, so the order is not important if you are using this notation. So let's say or. Okay, so this is called the double integral. The double integral of f on r. Okay, so again, forget about this interpretation. Okay, so we use this condition that f is positive to draw such pictures. Forget about the pictures. Okay, so just consider a function, a rectangle, a partition like this. Okay, so we can always form such a limit, and then what we are doing is we are checking if this limit exists or not. Okay, so we write this thing, and then we look at limit n and m go to infinity without depending on each other. We have this Riemann sum of f on r depending on m. Okay, if this limit exists, then we denote it by the double integral. The limit is called double integral. And it is, you have to use some notation. So this is one of the one of the notations. And later on, when you start working on 3, 4, 5 dimensional integrals, then you will get tired of writing 5 integrals side by side here. So if you read a little bit advanced books or articles on this, you see that integral is always given. Integral, a single integral of f over whatever region. Okay, so the dimension is clear in the context. If you start to calculate it, okay, so we'll come to that in a minute. Calculating is different, but when you are writing the symbol, you can also write integral of f on r. Okay, but don't use this notation in calculus, because in calculus when we are reading papers, we want to check that you are using the proper calculus notation. Okay, but you see this one is also, as long as you understand what it says, it is correct. Integral of f on this region. Okay. Okay, so the next question is, do you know any function for which this strange limit will exist? Well, okay, we know one function. If f is constant, okay, then it defines a box here, a rectangular box. Obviously, the first, whichever partition you choose, you will immediately get the volume of the box. So when you take the limit, you are not changing anything. So, okay, we have one type of functions, the constants, but that's not interesting because if you have a constant function, if you want to find the volume of a rectangular box, no one uses integrals. So what are other types of interesting functions? It turns out that if f is continuous, this limit always exists. Okay, so that's one of the big theorems. Okay, so theorem. If f is continuous on R, then double integral of f on R exists. Okay, so let me say double integral of f on R exists. Okay, so the book says that the proof of this is too deep to write in a calculus book. Actually, it's not too deep. It's a little bit long. The ideas are very simple. The idea depends on the following property of a continuous function. Okay, for example, what is continuity? Continuity is something that you always measure at a point. Okay, so suppose you have an interval. Here, the same idea works on on a rectangle. If you do this for triple integrals in a box, etc. Okay, so suppose on an interval, okay, you always calculate continuity, you check continuity at a point. You say that I want the values of f not to differ more than epsilon. Okay, so then there is always a small neighborhood around that point where wherever you calculate the values of f, they will differ by epsilon, okay, not more than epsilon. Okay, but if you move to a different point, the size of this small neighborhood may change. Okay, if f and if f is continuous but the interval has is bounded and includes the endpoints, what we call closed and bounded. Okay, so then you find you can find a fix in length. Okay, so you can make your fingers like this, and wherever you put your two fingers on the interval, you calculate the value of the function here and the here, the difference will be less than epsilon. Okay, so the fact that you can find the distance for your fingers to do this is a special property of continuous functions on closed and bounded intervals. Okay, so for example, the function 1 over x is continuous on the open interval from 0 to 1. 0 is not included because the function is not defined there. For on that interval, you cannot play this game because as you are approaching zero, if you want the values of 1 over x to differ by, say, 5,000, your fingers must come closer and closer to each other because as 1 over x approaches to zero, it shoots to infinity and it speeds up. So you cannot find a fixed interval there. But if the function is also defined at zero and if it is continuous, then you can always find such a fixed distance. Okay, so this property is called uniform continuity. To prove that continuous functions are uniformly continuous on closed and bounded intervals in Rn requires a few steps. Nothing deep, but it requires to do some work. Okay, so that's why it's not mentioned in calculus books where application is important. Okay, so we do this mostly in for math majors because closed and bounded generally is referred to compact in mathematics. A continuous function on a compact set is uniformly continuous, etc. Okay, now that being said, how do we use this? You see, when you are taking this point arbitrarily in the partition, you say, I'll take the point where f has its minimum. F is continuous on a closed and bounded set, so it has minimum and maximum there. So in this sum, first you always choose the minimum point. Okay, so you obtain such a sum. This is called the lower Riemann sum, corresponding to n and m. Okay, obviously this is bounded from above. Okay, so take the maximum of f on all of these intervals. Consider this volume of the rectangular box. This sum cannot exceed that. Okay. Then we refer to a property of real numbers. Since if you increase n and m, this is going to increase. Okay. So lower sums go to increase. Upper sums decrease. Upper sums are the ones corresponding to maximum values. Okay. So each of them has a limit. But the general theory of real numbers tells us that both of them has a limit. Now, in the last step, you have to show that these two limits are the same, so that the actual limit without any restrictions will exist. That's why you use this uniform continuity. Okay, you can choose n and m so large. Okay, so you are making your fingers close to each other, so that the minimum and maximum values of the function here will be less than epsilon, say. Okay, then the limit, so limit of lower sums and limit of upper sums will be less, the difference between them will be less than epsilon, but epsilon was arbitrary, so the two limits will be the same. Okay, so you see there was no deep idea in this, except that it took me 5 minutes to go over this. If you write this, it will take a little bit longer. So that's why we don't include this in calculus book. But what I'm objecting is that the book says it's so deep, you can't understand this, so I'm passing it. It's not true. You can understand it, but it's a little bit long. And we are not going to use the techniques of that proof anywhere else in this calculus. So when that's the case, we skip the proof, but then you have to be honest. You have to say that I'm skipping the proof because the ideas that are going to be employed in the proof will not be used later on in the book, so let us not spend time on it. We can always go to a more serious calculus book and check the proofs. Okay, so this is the big theorem. If f is continuous, then double integrals will exist. Remember that this was the same theorem when f is a single variable function. If f is continuous, its integral exists. The proof is exactly the same. Okay, instead of referring to an integral, here we refer to a region. Later on, you can refer to a box in R3. Okay, but we need a little bit more than this. Okay, so if, say, let's say as a continuation of theorem, in fact, if f is continuous on R except on finitely many continuous paths, let's say curves, then still the double integral exists. So this part, at this point, it looks, why bother with this thing? But in a minute, we will use this. Okay. You see, not all functions are defined on rectangles. If f is defined on a slightly different region, then we will extend the function by zero to a rectangle. Then the boundary of our region will be points of discontinuity. But if the region is nice, the boundary will consist of only finitely many continuous curves, and that's the only point where the function may jump. So the theorem will tell us that it is still integral. So this second part doesn't require any idea either. You can easily show this if you are interested in proofs. Okay, we have a terminology. Okay, so it's always bothersome to say that the double integral exists, etc. We just say f is integrable. Okay. If the double integral exists of f exists on R, we say f is integrable on R. So you see, we have to also mention the region with function, because if the function behaves badly at some point, it doesn't mean that the function is a bad function. You just stay away from the points where the function behaves badly, then it's a nice function. So that's why we keep referring to the region. Okay, so our theorem says that continuous functions are integrable. Moreover, if the function fails to be continuous on a small set, it's still integrable. So this small set is the, you see, we can talk about the area. Okay, so if you go a little bit more into the theory of this, if f is continuous on a region, except on a set of area zero, which we generally call measure zero, then f is integrable. This area zero part, you can convince yourself is enough, because you see you are multiplying the base area by height. Okay, if the base area is small, if the base area is zero, then multiplying with height will not contribute anything good or bad to your calculation. So if f fails to be integrable on a small set, then it will be integrable. But with the Riemann sums, we want to have full control of how the bad set is. So our bad sets will be continuous curves. Okay, we need this continuity because later on we'll integrate the equations of these continuous curves. Okay, so that's the general theory of this. So let me see what else we are supposed to talk about in the book. Okay, so as we said, this is the volume. Okay, so okay, we will not do the midpoint rule, etc., because we will not be working on actual actual Riemann sums. These Riemann sums are useful when you don't have much information about the function. You just know some discrete data. So from that discrete data, you get an approximate idea about the integral. Okay, so this is better than none. But we will not go into that. We will be interested in cases where we can actually calculate the integral. Okay, so that's the theory. We defined something. Now, how do we calculate this? This was again the question we asked in the one-dimensional case. We defined one-dimensional integrals in exactly the same way, except the dimension was one, and we had the same theorem. And then next question is, okay, this is very nice, but how do you calculate this? Nobody wants to calculate these Riemann sums because it's not easy and sometimes impossible to find the limit starting from that definition. And there the answer came with the fundamental theorem of algebra. Okay, fundamental theorem of calculus. Fundamental theorem of algebra is different. Okay, so that tells every polynomial has a root, but fundamental theorem of calculus says that integration and differentiation are inverse operators. If you can correctly formulate this relation, you can calculate integrals. Okay, so now we want to reduce this to that situation. Okay, question? Bunu niye indirdim? Burası da izlemiş. Okay, so it is reasonable to expect that for a double integral, I have to calculate two single integrals. Okay, so how that will be? So let's say. Okay, so the next question is, how do we calculate f of the double integral of f on r? Okay, so that's the question. Let's put a question mark. Okay. So the answer will be given by the Frobenius theorem. Okay, so it says that it is given as an iterated integral. Okay, so let me write this. Okay, let's draw the picture. So this is our picture, x, y. We have this rectangle. So this is A, this is B, C, and D. And f is a function from here to r. Okay, so we don't need positivity anymore. You see, we got rid of the positivity. This was only to draw nice pictures. Of course, you can also draw nice pictures when f is sometimes negative, but not with your hand. You have to use some software. Okay, so Fibonacci theorem says that the double integral of f on R is going to be iterated integrals. First, you integrate this f x y, say dx. This is the function of x and y. We can always treat y as a constant for the time being. Okay, so this is a function of x. I integrate it with respect to x. Wherever I see y, I treat it as a constant. Okay, so this is sometimes difficult to do psychologically, but when you are doing calculations, just concentrate on x. Okay, you are integrating this with respect to x. So x is from a to b. So x equals a to x equals b. And then you see when you calculate this part, I'm putting a parenthesis now, but generally we don't put parentheses. This is just to see what's happening. Okay. A and B are numbers. You integrate this with respect to X, treating Y as a constant. And for every value of X after finding the antiderivative, you put X equals A or X equals B, add, subtract, whatever. Now, at the end, you have only numbers and Y. Okay, so X is treated. X gave its place to numbers. Okay, so now all you have is a function of y. So you integrate this function of y. Y equals from c to y equals d. Okay, so that looks reasonable. In most cases, we don't put the parentheses. Or Fubini says that we have integral from x equals a to x equals b, integral y equals c, y equals d, f of x, y, dy, dx. Okay. So I hope I wrote this properly. And this is when, the important thing is this is when f is continuous. Okay, so fortunately our functions will be very nice functions most of the time. But it's not except in very pathological cases. If you can write down an expression for f, it is continuous, differentiable, etc. Okay, so if you start playing with the formulas, you cut and paste them, then you start having problems. But most of the time, if you write f as a, most of our functions will be trigonometric or polynomial or rational functions. So wherever they are defined, they will be continuous. So for calculus, we don't have much problem. Okay, so the proof of this thing is, I will not go into the proof of this thing. The book gives a proof for this. This is just the implementation of slicing. And the proof, of course, the book does not give a general proof of this. The book assumes again that f is positive. Then we are talking about the volume. And last semester we had techniques of calculating volumes by slicing. Okay, so you can slice it this way and add the area of that slice, or you can slice it the other way and add the areas of those slices. Both of those techniques will give you the volume. And if f is positive, this is volume in our interpretation. So that's a proof of Fubini's theorem when f is positive and continuous. Okay, but the theorem generally holds whether f is positive or not. So I will not go into that proof. So this is what happens when f is continuous. Okay, so this answers this question in most cases because you see. We know how to calculate integrals of this. Fundamental theorem of calculus tells us that you find an antiderivative of this, evaluate it here, evaluate here, and take the difference. Okay? So here the bottleneck is finding an antiderivative of this. For nice functions, we know antiderivatives, but if you pick an arbitrarily function from the box of, from the sack of all continuous functions, the chances are that you don't have a nicely expressed antiderivative for that. Okay, so for those functions, we say they are not elementary functions. If you can write down the antiderivative of a function in terms of some known functions, then okay, that's a nice function, but the others are not elementary. So that's why these techniques, these observations become useful. Since you cannot precisely calculate the derivative, antiderivative, then you cannot calculate the integral, but you need that number, so you start using different techniques to approximate the integral. And this is one thing to keep in mind. Of course, there are much faster techniques, but again, in calculus, we don't go into that. Okay, so let me start with one easy example from the book. Okay, we'll do iterative integrals and then. Okay, let me do an example of an iterative integral. So this is a simple integral to exercise our nerves to see this as a function of x, keeping y as a constant, and then we integrate later with respect to y. Okay, so example of an iterated integral. So maybe I mentioned that such integrals are called iterated integrals. Okay, so you integrate this function of two variables one by one with respect to integrals. So a simple example of an iterated integral. Okay, so let's invent something. X, y squared, dx, dy. X goes from 0 to 1, y goes to, okay, let's make it easy. So it goes from 0 to 2. Okay, so now here the picture. Well, this is a very simple example. We don't need to draw a picture, but with the double integrals, triple integrals, it is always necessary, at least advisable, to draw pictures as much as you can. Here the picture is this. With rectangles, of course, this picture is not necessary, but so this is 1, this is 2, so this is the point 1, 2. We are integrating this function. You see that this function is positive on this region. Well, okay, here and here the function is 0, but then you have something like this on top of this. So this will calculate the volume of that region. Volume that lies above this rectangle under this graph. Okay, so what you do is first you treat this part. Okay, so I'm keeping 0 to 2 as it is. Okay, so when I integrate this, a constant times x, I integrate it. It is that constant divided by 2, x squared. Okay, so this is 1 over 2, x squared, y squared. Okay, take the derivative of this with respect to x. You should get this. Okay. Then I integrate, I evaluate this. Let me emphasize that x is from 0 to 1. Then I'll obtain something. I'll integrate it with respect to y. Okay. So let's see how it goes from 0 to 2. So this is y squared over 2, right? So I'll take 1 over 2 out, y squared dy. Okay. So this is now 1 over 3, so this is equal to 1 over 2, 1 over 3 y cubed from 0 to 2. Okay. So this is 8 over 6. Okay, so this is what we are going to do. And in fact, here, you see, Fubini says that you could have done it in the other order. Okay, so if my calculations are correct, I should get the same number. So I reverse the order here. 0, 1, 0, 2, x, y square, dy, dx. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so let me do this and we'll stop. 0, 1, 1 over 3, x, y cube. From y equals 0 to y equals 2 dx. Okay, so this is 8 over 3. I take it out, 0, 1. What is left is x dx. So this is 8 over 3, x squared over 2 from 0 to 1. And that gives the same number. Okay. So what we did here is when we are changing the places, we just change the places of this. That's because we had constants here. Okay? So this is not going to be just a simple change of integral signs when we have some functions here. Okay? So we'll come to that next hour. Okay? Let's take a break.